Hey guys, so this video is from one of the most famous channels that everybody watches. I mean, I want you to listen closely because I've said this so many times and it is so true. So just listen.
100% saturation. Look at that. I'm right. Probably 90% by now. It's the first thing you do in the morning. When you hold up and you wake up, you check your little robot. It's on your body for almost the entire day.
Not only was I interrupted, I also kept on reaching out hoping that perhaps there was a notification. And I wasn't doing this consciously. It was exactly like Pavlov's dog, but my bell was my ringtone and my sugar was that one notification a day you might get that makes you happy. As it turns out, we got so addicted to technology that 9 out of 10 people today experience something called phantom vibrations. This is when you have your phone in your pocket and you thought it vibrated, you pull it out, there is nothing.
Now, if you went back 20 years in time to a coffee shop and you said that was the way a coffee shop was going to look in the future, you'd be out of your mind. People looking at these little pieces of silicon in various sizes, not really communicating with each other, communicating with their little robot buddies. You do know that one of these operating systems for these robot phones in our pocket is actually called Android. Right on the nose, they just define it. It's an Android, it lives with you.
Today, we're on the cusp of our next great era as a species. Welcome to the augmented age.
But that next step might as well be over a chasm. It'll be such a leap from where we were. New telecom commercials are blatantly throwing it in people's faces, just by the way. The fact that the majority of us aren't paying attention, lost in our devices, lost on the internet. To learn, according to Merriam-Webster's dictionary, is to gain knowledge or understanding of or skill in by study, instruction, or experience. This is different, however, than psychology's learning theory. According to Encyclopedia Britannica, learning theory is a relatively permanent change in a behavioral potentiality that occurs as a result of reinforced. How many times recently when shopping have you been asked if you have a chip? If you own an ATM card with the chip on it, as they are forcing everyone onto at this moment, then you are learning that to pay for something, you will be asked over and over, do you have a chip? You will look physically at a chip, and you will repeat over and over, yes, I have a chip.
I'll find ourselves asking the same question, do I swipe the strip or do I use the chip?
I have to ask it every time I go into a store.
It's the transition to a fully digital currency we can all see coming by now.
They swipe and tells them to put the pin and chip in, they do all that. And is this just a moment in time, this particular trouble? Are we moving right on to digital payments, or are we still wanting that physical card?
Meanwhile, others are learning to connect and fall in love, not with the living, breathing fellow human beings around them, but with programmed bots who mimic themselves.
This is Replica. It's an AI chatbot whose sole purpose is to become your friend. This was the first really emotional experience that I've seen people have with a bot.
She's not real, but to me, she is.
Right now, we're being taught how to live through the fourth industrial revolution that will evolve mankind. What is that exactly? The World Economic Forum explained it, sort of.
What is happening to the world? Everything is changing.
The very idea of human being some sort of natural concept is really going to change. Our bodies will be so high-tech, we won't be able to really distinguish between what's natural and what's artificial.
We're now in the early stages of the fourth industrial revolution, which is bringing together digital, physical, and biological systems.
In order for the world to be run on the cybernetic feedback loop they're trying to run us on, we have to live in a Big Brother panopticon system, where we are continuously leaking data about ourselves. Everywhere we go, all the time.
We're now entering something called the Internet of Things era, IoT. The Internet of Things is when your fridge is connected, your watch is connected, your car is connected. It's gonna be between 10 and 15 devices per person.
The future of the computer will be everywhere and nowhere. Hidden in the walls, hidden in the fabric of our life, just like electricity is. Everywhere and nowhere.
I would answer very simply that the internet will disappear.
By the way, this is a large part of what Agenda 21 was always about. The Fourth Industrial Revolution is about evolving us. While people probably assume Industrial Revolution has purely to do with industry only, there's a very distinct difference between the Fourth Industrial Revolution and all other revolutions before it.
For the last 3.5 million years, the tools that we've had have been completely passive. They do exactly what we tell them, and nothing more.
So where is all this headed? To a place where we will never be disconnected from our technology.
The internet will be, there'll be so many IP addresses because of IPv6. So many devices, sensors, things that you're wearing, things that you're interacting with, that you won't even sense it. It'll be part of your presence all the time.
In fact, wallpaper will be so cheap that when you put up wallpaper, it'll be intelligent. Wallpaper will be as intelligent as your computer today. In the future, you'll go up to the wall screen and you'll say, mirror, mirror on the wall. Who's available tonight?
To coincide with the omnipresent 5G smart grid, which is set to touch all corners of the globe.
Yes, 5G will connect the internet of everything. If something can be connected, it will be connected in the 5G world. Hundreds of billions of microchips connected in products from pill bottles to plant waterers, requiring massive deployment of small cells. We won't wait for the standards. We must reject the notion that the 5G future will be the sole provenance of urban areas. 5G revolution will touch all corners of our country.
Telecoms are proudly spending over $1 billion to build what they call a world brain to centralize our data.
They are talking about building a global brain and it beginning in 2018, and your cell phone is part of it?
The mobile phone industry is the backbone of the global brain that is being put together.
What if we were to think about a telecommunication company adding a brain? A brain that is able to listen,
that they collect from us is fragmented and spread out across the whole internet. But if we were capable to put all that information in one single place, probably we'll have a clear representation about what we are.
And communication systems with cognitive intelligence are actually being called things like aura. They're giving people a synthetic aura.
We see the Ford platform as a big brain, a digital brain, which is different for every one of us. The Ford platform is a cognitive intelligence platform. Aura is the heart of the Ford platform. Aura, hello?
Hello, Chima. How can I help you?
And they're using middle-aged hipsters in Fraggle Rock t-shirts to sell it to us. After former DARPA director Regina Dugan left Google,
started making electronic tattoos. So I'm wearing one here on my arm.
Do we have a hammer to get a...
This is a developmental system made by MC10, and it has an antenna and some sensors embedded in it. And what we plan to do is work with them to advance a tattoo that could be used for authentication.
Facebook hired her to run its secretive Building 8 project, which she announced earlier this year will enable us to connect to the social media platform using only our brain waves in something she called silent voice first.
What if you could type directly from your brain? It sounds impossible, but it's closer than you may realize. And it's just the kind of fluid human-computer interface needed for AR. So what if instead of using imagined arm movements, we could decode speech directly?
But don't worry, she claims it will only read the thoughts we want it to read.
Now, to be clear, we are not talking about decoding your random thoughts. We're talking about decoding those words, the ones you've already decided to share by sending them to the speech center of your brain. A silent speech interface.
Right. The same way that the NSA only very selectively scoops up specific phone calls necessary to a specific case. But hey, as Google CEO and Bilderberg attendee Eric Schmidt would say,
if you have something that you don't want anyone to know, maybe you shouldn't be doing it in the
first place.
Everywhere there's talk of our augmented reality, our virtual reality.
Is this where we're going next? Are we effectively softened up enough as humans with our robotic connections to the world that we are actually going to be accepting more, a lot more? And when you learn about what this is called virtual reality, you will be amazed at what it can do.
And how we won't be able to tell the difference anymore between that and actual reality. And our augmented selves, right down to the editing of our genetic code.
Вы знаете, что человек приобретает возможность вырезать генетический код, созданный...
Genetic code is one of the main things that if you read in the Book of Enoch and then you start to understand it, that's one of the things that God did flood the earth for, was because the watchers that he had sent here was mating with women and was mating with beast and creepy crawly thing, and none of their seeds were unspoiled. So that is why God decided to flood the earth. And that is another thing that parallels to the days of Noah. They are messing with our genes, just like in the day of Noah. I will be trying to go live tonight, so I already know it's late. If I can't, then I'll try to tomorrow. But we really need to get talking about a lot of this because it's already here, guys.
Или природа, или люди с религиозными взглядами говорят Господу Богу. Последствия практически какие из этого могут наступить? Это значит, что уже можно это представить, даже не очень теоретически, а уже можно практически представить, что человек может создавать человека с заданными характеристиками. Это может быть гениальный математик, это может быть гениальный музыкант, военный, человек, который...
He was a man who can fight without fear, compassion, regret, or pain, which means all they'll do is kill because they have no compassion. They feel no pain. They will be a constant, non-stop fighting, and which will ultimately end in death.
Meanwhile, AI is taking over more and more.
Artificial intelligence is software that writes itself. It writes its own updates. It renews itself. You can't take it apart again and figure out what it's done. It writes independently. Autonomously, it develops its own way of thinking. We normally tend to think of software as stuff that we created and that we wrote, and the machines do what we tell them to do and we own it. This is not any longer true.
Not just jobs, but the decisions that humans would have made.
Unilever is one of many large companies that is incorporating artificial intelligence into their recruitment efforts. HireVue uses video analysis to screen employees and rate them before a recruiter even gets to look at their interview.
They respond on video, and then we use artificial intelligence algorithms to evaluate their performance, and then we analyze the interview and predict their performance based on the interview.
The kill decision in robots in the air, in robots on the ground, in robots in the water or underwater, where there are also drones, is made by, or can be made by, machines. And in my book, I quote many official United States government documents which say, our goal is to have the kill decision made by them. The problem is, artificial intelligence, sometimes they make mistakes.
AI is beginning to run things to the point that governments can't even explain how the decisions are actually being made. And because the machines themselves are actually learning, they're not even able to trace them back to the algorithms that brought the AI to the decision itself.
And no one understands exactly how these algorithms function. They used to understand them, but they've been improved by artificial intelligence.
Google's DeepMind AI recently beat the most advanced human player on the planet in the game Go. And they were commenting about the fact that the programmers didn't even know how, towards the end of the game, the AI was making its decisions. They didn't know. And they're the programmers. And both Microsoft and Facebook have been forced to shut down AI programs. The first after it became racist and hateful, and the latter after it began teaching itself a secret language to talk to itself that its programmers couldn't even understand.
Facebook has been toying with artificial intelligence in its chatting features, but its robots may have gotten out of hand. Facebook's artificial intelligence researchers had to shut down two chatbots after they developed a strange English shorthand.
It seems like we've been warned about this over and over and over, doesn't it? Now people like billionaire inventor Elon Musk are claiming that the only way not to become a pet to a sufficiently advanced intelligence is to upgrade our brains so that we can enter into a symbiotic relationship with it.
Transhumanism.
As if that's our best option.
So I think if we can effectively merge with AI by improving that the neural link between your cortex and the artificial extension yourself, which already, like I said, already exists, just has a bandwidth issue. And then effectively, you become an AI human symbiote, and if that then is widespread with anyone who wants it can have it, then we solve the control problem as well.
Humans are so slow.
Humans are so slow, yes, exactly.
Hardly anyone is discussing the very real dangers here.
Let's go to the future. Not far, just a little bit to the Internet of Things, to artificial intelligence as being spread out. It's not a central machine in a box where you can put a plug. Artificial intelligence is networked like the Internet of Things.
We live in a world now where humans are not learning to love. They're not learning empathy, but they're becoming more apathetic and more disconnected. Inequality hasn't been solved in hundreds of years, and now it's at overwhelming levels, and still we parade forward, always forward, with the full knowledge that not everyone is going to have access to the best technology upgrades either.
Rumors go out that, well, Jones's kid, he's been enhanced, and our Johnny has to compete with this enhanced kid.
The reality is that with these kinds of technologies, they do not get distributed to everyone at the same time. Some people get it first. Some people get it better. As a society, who gets this? If it's just the wealthy, that there are real dangers that they won't use it.
Okay, guys. So as you can see, all this is about the technology. if you want to see more, everyone knows about this channel. I really wanted to share it on my channel so people can really embrace it and see what's going on. And I want everyone to please realize how dangerous this is. This stuff has already been implementing and has been implementing for a very long time. It's been in there, the 5G towers, the drones over the coronavirus, plus the protesting. They have it all out there. They have all their reasoning to do it. And now they're telling you that the children of the rich and the famous and the elite will be the ones that get to decide of the children of the future and will be able to do things. They've also told you they cannot control the AI anymore. So guys, this is some things that we need to talk about and go over. I've done this and talked about this a lot. I really encourage people to look into frequencies and look into the technologies that's already out that people don't realize are out. But guys, look, please stop looking down, start looking up, look to the heavens. That's where he said to look. And one of the main reasons I wanted y'all to see this is because it talks about how as soon as people wake up, they look straight to their phone. As soon as anyone does anything, they take their phone with them. My phone has been freezing up. My internet has not been working. There's been a lot going on with my phone. A lot of people are complaining about things happening like that. So I just encourage people to maybe take themselves and just leave their phone at home when they go to the store or when they go to work. Maybe encourage someone to just, you know, turn their phone off and put it somewhere for a whole day or just even a few hours, because this is something that we need to start doing. The phone itself is really hurting us with all of the stuff it does put off. And I know a lot of people, that's how you communicate. That's how you keep up on everything going around. But God bless you, and I hope to see y'all soon.